Becoming a student. A student. Amen. Becoming a student. Becoming a student. There's good students. There's bad students. But there's no such thing. There shouldn't be any bad students. It shouldn't be, but, you know. I've seen, remember with CJ when he was in school, the teachers said he wasn't getting it. I said, well, maybe y'all can't reach him. So they decided to give him another teacher, and he started making good grades. And when we met back up, I said, and I told y'all, every teacher don't mean you can reach every student. But there are certain teachers that are gifted to reach certain kind of children. And that's true. It's no knock on the teacher. But God don't, I was looking at the perspective and the point of view that God don't make dumb people. That's how I see it. If you living below your standard is because you choose to. God does not make failures. You choose failure. Right? You choose to be inadequate. You choose it. Everything in life is a choice. Is that true? It's a choice. I choose to live out my life and to grow and to keep growing till I get off this earth. That's my choice. That's my God-given right. Amen. Because we don't get worser with age, we get better. I'm talking spirit now. I ain't talking about your flesh. See, the real you is spirit. If I could ever get the church to bite into that one, you're a spirit. You real you is spirit. The real you is spirit. The Spirit of God lives in us. Amen? All right. Ephesians 4, I'll read it from the King James, and we'll go forth setting up this lesson here this morning. Therefore, this is Paul penning this through the Holy Spirit. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord. Amen. Beseech you. I beg you. That you walk means to live worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. What are you talking about? What are you called into? We'll deal with that. With all lowliness. And meekness, and long-suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring, that means doing whatever it takes, to keep the unity of the Spirit. Amen. We should go to the extreme to keep the peace and the unity of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So, what is Paul saying here today? What is he saying to us? We're talking about a student, becoming a student of eternal life, Zoe life, salvation, the God kind of life, abundant life. We have to become a student. Paul is saying, since God has summoned you, since he has called you, walk worthy of this calling. Salvation. Eternal life. You're going to have to walk worthy of this vocation. This is what Paul is saying. Walk worthy of this calling. Salvation is a calling? Yeah. You didn't know that? Salvation is a calling. It's a divine calling. Amen. It's God calls you. God have to call you to him. It's a calling. It is a calling. It is a calling. It is a calling. It is a calling. I'm going to say it again. It is a calling. Walk worthy. Paul said, I'm a prisoner of the Lord. I don't do what I want to do. I don't go where I want to go. Paul, what Terrence was saying this morning in Sunday school, I'm crucified with Christ. A prisoner don't just leave and go when he wants to. Look, I'm going to see my parents, and I'll be back. He ain't checked with the warden or the guard to go to the warden. He just say he got to go. That don't work like that. Paul said, I'm a prisoner. I live, move, and have my being in Christ. To live is Christ. If you ain't living toward allowing the Holy Spirit to live in you, to live is Christ. Christos, the anointing. Amen. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, I beseech you that you walk worthy of the calling. Vocation means calling, wherewith you are calling, your occupation. Vocation is the what you've been called to, your salvation. You got to be trained in with all lowliness. Why? Because Jesus was got them disciples up on the mount and started dealing with them about, he was talking to them about a person that would become a disciple and how a disciple should be, how that attitude should be as becoming a follower of Christ. You need to be humble because you didn't save yourself. It's by grace, God's ability that you're saved. It was God's ability that woke you up this morning. It is God's ability that kept you all last week. It's God, it's God, it's God, it's God. It's God, it's God, it's God. It's God, it's God, it's God, it's God. It's God, it's God. Do I need to keep going with that? I got it etched in my mind, just like these old tattoos on my arm that I put there. Them tattoos don't never remind me how stupid I used to be. I'm talking about me, so don't nobody please. I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about me because I was stupid. I was 15, unsupervised. If somebody had been around me, had told me not to do that, and told me this is why, I wouldn't have did it. I wouldn't have did it. My daddy had was in the Navy. He got a tattoo on his arm. Guess where I got it from? Him. Amen. So the Amplifier said, so I, the prisoner for the Lord, appeal to you, still begging you, to live a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called. We got to live worthy. Now, we're not going to be like over in Ezekiel. God told them, everywhere you went, you profane my name among the heathen. But he said, I'm going to straighten my name up. I'm going to do this for my name's sake. I'm gonna fix my name because you went in and out among the heathens and y'all messed my name up, but I got to restore my name. So I'm going to take the old spirit out. I'm going to give you a new spirit. Why? Because I want my name is on the line. So I'm going to give you something to help you in your calling. I'm going to give you something to help you walk this thing out. So you won't mess up my name. So now, because I know people have told their children, the name of our family means something. Don't tarnish our name. Hold up our name. And the Christians should be that way. We should be that way. Amen? We should be that same way. So, saints of God, we as believers, I was talking about this Wednesday night, the definition of faithfulness. This is what a believer in the Greek is. Faithful and reliable as you grow and transition. Now, I looked up the word transition, and I'm like, to my hurt and surprise, they put it toward transgender. I'm like, wow, they put it toward transgender, transitioning. Because I was writing down my subject, we're talking about becoming a student of eternal life. But my subtopic is transitioning from a sinner to a saint. And I said, let me look up what the world got to say about it. A person is transitioning from who they was born with and who they've been feeling with on the inside all the time. I said, okay, God, I can get with that. I can get with that. You know, as a little boy, I always knew God was going to use me. But something was in me as a little boy. So I said, okay, definition, I can get with that because God, it was something in me, had me focusing on a God that I really didn't know. So I guess transition, it was something in me wanted to get out. That's what I was looking at. I began to think about when I would hear God call my name and when I could hear God clear. I would have dreams about God. And as a little boy from 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12, I used to say, I know I'm going to be doing something for God. I don't know what it is, but I know I'm going to be doing something for God. And I could dream something, and it would happen. I dreamed, you remember Ms. Johnson, somebody ran in her bedroom? I dreamed it the night before. A car ran straight up into this house. I had dreamed it. So God's hand has always been on me. So God was summoning, calling me at an early age. Guess when I surrendered? 26. God never wanted me to experience a lot of that mess that I experienced. And transitioning from a sinner to a saint. What is that? What is that? How do you transition? Okay, first of all, you what? Accept Jesus Christ as your what? Lord and Savior. Not just Savior, Lord. So let me say this. Lord, Master, Teacher, Student, must now the Master, Jesus is being your Savior is one thing, but being your Master, Lord, His teachings alter your life. They carry great weight in your life now. What the Master say turns your life in one direction or another. You're not moved by your feelings and emotions. The Master teaching governs your thought patterns now. What He said, because He's your Lord, has great consequences over your life now. That's when Jesus knows He's your Master and Lord. But to say He's Lord and do not what He say is a whole different story. So now Jesus is Savior, that's a whole nother one thing, but He's your Lord and Savior. He is your Lord, He is your Master, and His teaching is supposed to have a great, great, what's the word I'm looking for, y'all? Help me out, help me. Supposed to help influence your life and the decisions that you make. And if His teaching is not impacting and influence your life, He's not your Master. When I was under Satan tutelage, He impacted my life for the bad. I was miserable. I had demons in me. I know I had demons. I could feel them. People knew it. That's why people got away from around me. When I came up, I didn't just come by myself. I had stuff in me that was following me. I'm a pretty cool, laid-back guy till you cross the line with me. I ain't crossed the line with nobody. And I don't want nobody messing with me. So I was so depressed and demonically messed up and demonized, I would black out. When I get that mad, I would literally black out and wouldn't know it. I'd be fighting and doing some everything, but I wouldn't be there. Them demons would enhance me. Just like now the Holy Spirit enhanced me. Uh-oh. See, I learned how to follow God by allowing the demons to run my life. And God told me, I need for you to surrender to me like you did to them demons. So I made a transition. I went from following Satan to God. What is a disciple? A disciple is a follower. It is a follower. A true disciple is not just involved, but is committed to take up his own cross and follow Jesus to the very end. Remember, the race is not given to the swift nor the battle to the strong. It is the one who endures to the end. This is not a sprint. This is a marathon. And yeah, you're going to hit here and miss here, but you stay with it. Joe Nathan, you stick with it, man. Jalen, stick with it. All of us in here, Hen, stick with it. All of us, young lady, stick with it. All of us in here. Marshawn, we got to stick with this. Because, I believe, well, have your belief turned into commitment? Has it turned into loyalty? It did when I was a sinner. Everybody knew I was a sinner. They saw my works. You know, somebody said this a long time ago. Oh, well, Daniels ain't this and that. You know what I told him? Check my track record. Look at my works. If I'm fake, then my works will prove I'm fake. And I didn't heal anybody. God healed them through me. Jesus said, if you don't believe on the Messiah, don't believe me. Believe the works. That's the evidence. Your life. And what it produces is the evidence that you're saved. That's where I got that from. Check my track record out. How many people have got delivered? How many people have got healed? How many God, and I didn't do it. God did it through me. And if I was such evil, how could God do that through me? Satan ain't healing nobody. Oh, they got mad. That made them even more hot. Because they couldn't keep saying the thing that they were saying. If I'm that evil, how are these people getting healed? In the little old bitty building with the rock parking lot. And nobody's getting healed and delivered over here where the... That person got mad with me, which I didn't care. Well, are we ready to make a transition? I'm not talking about gender bending. Now, I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about making a decisive decision to follow Jesus. Because I'm going to an illustration in a little bit that it was clear. It's clear. Is this clear? Can everybody see this? Is this clear? Not so clear. Not so clear. Unless you got contacts on and they precision pinpoint. You got a telescope, got a scope. This ain't clear. But this is. This clear. That's how we got to be as followers of Christ. We got to be like this. This person that I'm finna go to in the Bible is called a disciple, and you just didn't call a woman a disciple back in the day. But Luke thought it was appropriate through the power of the Holy Spirit to name this person a disciple. A disciple is a follower of his master teaching. Yes, Satan was my sensei because I did the things that Satan do. What are some of the works of Satan? What are some of the works of God? Is it clear without any shadow of a doubt? If somebody accused you of being a follower, they got enough evidence to convict you. Man, you've been in that cheesecake. Let me get a magnifying glass. I don't see no cheese. I don't see no graham cracker crust. I don't see none of that strawberry glaze on top of it. Man, you ain't been eating no cheesecake. Yes, I have. I love cheesecake, but the residue ain't on you. Let me leave that alone. Amen. Amen. Let me gather myself. Okay, it says, so I'm back over here in the Amplified. So I, the prisoner of the Lord, appeal to you to live a life worthy of the calling. Reggie, give me Romans 11 and 29, please. We got to live worthy. God, you God's child. Now, God is responsible for you. How many of y'all feel good about that? Mecca and Jeremy, y'all responsible for that child. I feel pretty good about that child care because y'all are responsible for that child care. Now, just think about the people who don't name God as their father. I feel sorry for those people because they don't have the care of a father, a loving father. They don't have that. Just like children growing up without their father. Every child need a parent. They need daddy. God did not make the family to be born of a father. And this is why coaches, all baseball coaches, football coaches, basketball coaches, track coaches, takes the place of a lot of fathers. That young men and young women, and some women and playing sports look at their coach as a male, a female coach, as a mother that they didn't have. But those men have given them guys something, and they never will forget it. And these guys grew up to train their sons and to be more hands-on with their sons. So when God calls you, it's more than just a job and a paycheck. Y'all better hear me. You ain't there for the money. You there because the kingdom is there. If the kingdom is in you, the kingdom is there. Pull this verse up. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. Now, if God called you to salvation, he ain't changed his mind. You change your mind. See, you can change your mind. Somebody can come. I'm going to use the prop. Y'all don't beat me up, Pastor and Tina. Don't beat me up. These are equally in size. Salvation. 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 Put that verse back up here. Now, that just popped up. That just came into my spirit to do that. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. In that gift is the calling to salvation. And it's without repentance. Meaning God ain't changing his mind. God says, I repented that I made man. For all of his thoughts were continually evil. God said, I hated I made man. He repented. He changed his mind. So he let everybody drown and started over. But you change your mind and won't open the gift. All of y'all. Let me see that. This is Joe Nathan. I don't want nobody to know I got a gift. See, I can get over here. Say this is a closed-in area. I'm at home sitting in a corner in a quiet place, and I confess Christ. You can do that privately. Joe Nathan don't want nobody to know he got the gift. Secret agent. Secret agent. Okay? Let me get that back to you. Give it in here. This is Henry. I got a gift. I got a gift. I got a gift. He bragging. I got a gift. Yeah. I got a gift. Yeah, you been opening it. I got a gift. I got a gift. Shoot. I got a gift. Look how pretty the rapids is. Look at the boat. Look at the boat. Look at the boat. Look at the boat. I got a gift. He ain't better do that with. But Jalen decides to open his gift. And a life begin to transition. The secret agent, Joe Nathan, sees it, get convicted. She ain't no better than me. We go to the same gate. I hear the same thing to you. Oh, I quote scriptures. But now he being convicted because he see a change in jailer. He, on the other word, still hollering about, I got a gift. I'm just as anointed as they are. I still got them, wears it on his shoulder. But now God allowed him to get offended, and he throws the gift back. He offended. Put that verse back up here. Get the logistics of this verse. For the gift and calling of God are without repentance. God didn't change his mind. Though you gave it back, still yours. God didn't change his mind. One day, the secret agent going to come out the closet. He coming out because he been called. God didn't change his mind. If God called you to something, yes, you may be jacking it up right now. Yes, it ain't good because you still don't want it. Your mind ain't really made up. But God didn't change his mind about saving you from yourself. God don't change his mind like that. One minute you like red, next minute you like blue, next minute you like polka dot. God ain't like that. No. God loves you and he ain't changing his mind. You may change your mind, but now if you don't never accept the gift, you may end up in hell, but God can't save you and make you be saved. God don't change his mind. The gifts and calling are without repentance. Is that a blessing? That's a blessing right there. Now, you can confess Christ in a woods. Nobody out there but you and God and the squirrels and the lizards and the snakes. But to be a disciple, you got to go public. You got to go public. Ain't no way you going to be a follower of Christ without being verbal and visible. You can confess Christ in the confinements of a bathroom stall, in your car in the parking lot. Nobody there but you. You can do that. But being a disciple of your master's teaching, Jesus' teaching, you got to be visible and verbal. It's got to be clearly demonstrated. Because it was clearly demonstrated that you were saved. Was it not? Did that help anybody? Amen, 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 amen. All right. It says a disciple is a follower. A true disciple is not just involved, but is committed to take up his cross and follow Jesus to the end. The name Christian, listen, the name Christian belonging to Christ, meaning belonging to Christ. The name Christian means belonging to Christ. Joe Nathan kept saying he's a Christian. Joe Nathan was a secret agent. It means belonging to Christ. Christian means belonging to Christ. Now, back in the biblical days over in Acts, it was a derogatory term to be associated with Christ, because Christ was a nobody. And to be called a Christian, they really would, what they call it? In the day's slang, what they call it? What they call it in the day's slang? How they dissing you or whatever they call it? What they call it, young folk? Come on. Yeah, you were being dissed by being called a Christian. It wasn't nothing big. But today, everybody said they belong to Jesus. Everybody saying that they like Christ. Is that true? Okay, let's say that is true. Walk worthy. Where my Bible at? Walk worthy. Let me continue to read. Say that is true. So, it says, I appeal to you to live a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called. That is to live a life that exhibits godly character, moral courage, personal integrity, and mature behavior. You got to walk worthy. Let me name them again. Which you have been called to live a life. Because did not Christ exhibit godly behavior? Did Christ have moral courage, spiritual courage? Did not Jesus have personal integrity and mature behavior? A life that expresses gratitude for God, to God for your salvation? Did not Jesus do all that? Okay, so now that you have went public, now that you have confessed Christ and went public, now you got to walk worthy. And he didn't leave you helpless where you couldn't walk. Well, he gave you something to help you to walk worthy of your calling. Amen. He didn't say, will you try? The what worthy because did you ever read in there what Jesus said? All power was given unto me in heaven and in earth, Matthew 28:18-19. Will you try to go into all the world? Will you try to feed the hungry? He ain't tried. God ain't asked us to try nothing. Will you try, Cain, to master sin? He didn't tell him that. Noah, will you try to build me a ark? I know it's rough. I know you got all these sinful practices around you, but I need for you to try to build this ark when you ain't, you know, distracted. Three Hebrew boys, I know it's rough. Y'all the only ones down here that's faithful to me, but I know when you want to bow, if you bow, I still love you, but will you try not to bow? Because they were the only one. Them were the only Jews. Every Jew bowed but them. And Daniel was off at school somewhere because Nebuchadnezzar sent him to school. But imagine three teenagers didn't bow and all of Israel who got taken in prisoner of war bowed. What is that telling you? Did he say try? No, he said do. Okay. Reggie, pull up Philippians 3 and 14. Oh, it's rebooting? Okay. I'll get over here. Let me finish reading this. Okay. With all what? Humility. That's why Jesus talked to them disciples. He said, blessed are the meek. Because you didn't save yourself. Humble yourself. You're saved because of God's grace. Humble yourself. You ain't got nothing to be lifted up and proud about. No believer got no business. Yeah, he and he is just a professing Christian and you don't see the fruit and we know what the root is. But Jalen then went on with our salvation and Joe Nathan done finally got converted and opened up, but there's no need for either one of them to put each other down. No, we're not going to do that. That ain't what we do. We don't put one another down. We build each other up. Amen? So it said, with all humility, forsaking self-righteous and gentleness, maintaining self-control. Be patient. bearing with one another in unselfish love. What is the greatest commandment? What is the first commandment? What is the greatest commandment? To love what? Number one. Who hit the ball and run to third base? My brother did that, but I don't know how he got a uniform because he was up there when he practiced. They gave him a uniform because of me. He hit the ball, ran to third base. Baseball game here. If you put the ball in play, you go where? Okay. To start this discipleship and student off, you got to do what? First base is love God. Second, third. Then now you can come home maybe after you get them three done. But no, me third. That's the average believer playing this game. They running the third. Me. What about me? Me. You can't see the blessing because you caught up with you. You got to go to first, God. You got to go to God first. Second, we finna talk about somebody who did those things. Let me get this other verse. Philippians 3 and 14. Read Galatians 4, please. That's a good chapter because it talks about Galatians 4, Ephesians 4. Sorry, I'm sorry, y'all. Ephesians 4th chapter. Let me get over here to Philippians, please. Oh. Here we go. 3 and 14. Big cat, I got on glasses. This is a little print, man. So I know you need some. Amen. All right. 13. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider, I'm going to get in 14, but I'm going to read 13, that I have made it my own yet. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider that I have made it my own yet. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind. You got to forget about your past life. You know why most people struggle with marriage? Because they still trying to be single. Men trying to be bachelors entered into a marriage. And some women trying to be single, trying to a bachelorette. No, you married now. You can't take that mindset into a union that's going to make you one. That's where the friction come in at. And I'm offsetting that with when you come into a relationship with God, you can't bring that old relationship that you had with Satan over in this relationship with God. God said, I'm married to the backslider. Wait a minute, Jesus said, if you friend with that old joke in the world, you're an enemy to me. Over there in James, didn't he say that? You can't do that. So it's going to be friction in the relationship. So many Christians, and that are Christians, bringing friction into their union with Christ through to God with that old relationship of sin. You cannot, you're not a sinner no more. Can we get that in your spirit? You're not a sinner. If it get in your spirit, it'll get in your head because you got to renew your mind. You're not a bachelor anymore. You're married. You ain't no player. I'm a bachelor, man. I got a stable. You a guy talking that crap. I got a stable. Stable of what? You ain't no bachelor no more. You ain't no sinner no more. You are Christ-like. You are in a relationship with God. You got to understand that. So we're gonna get all the friction out of our relationship by why? We're going to come all the way over to God. I'm married to the backslider. God said, I'm married. So you in a relationship with him. So you're going to get all the friction out. Is that helping anybody? Get the friction out of your relationship with God because God don't want the friction. All that friction coming about, you bringing that old stuff into a new relationship. What you did with Bobo and thick-thighed Thelma, you can't do with Hen or Joe Nathan or with Terrence. You can't do that. This is a new relationship. This is why you roll with Satan. You can't roll with God like that. He ain't going to them place. He ain't going. He'll let you go, but he ain't going. He'll turn that anointing down. Yeah. But since I hear, I go on witness. No. It says, reaching, forgetting what lies behind, and reaching forward to what lies ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the heavenly prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. I'm glad the Bible pointed out, the Amplified pointed it out. The King James said, I press toward the call for the mark, for the prize of a high calling. The Bible said a upward calling. You've been called from above. Now, mind you, the boy played Creed ain't calling you. Hollywood ain't calling. American Idol ain't calling. I'm talking about God, the one who created everything, the maker, the ruler, everything God, he's calling you. Wrap your mind around that. That all right? Nobody from Hollywood is calling. Nobody from the music industry is calling. God is calling you. The White House ain't calling. But God, I get it. I'd rather have God calling me than anybody. Any professional person, God called me. So I don't feel like I'm without. I don't feel neglected because I'm not in this group. I'm not associated with this group. I'm with him. I'm a verbal, visible follower. Is that clear? Well, I'm in Hollywood, but I'm saying it ain't clear. Like this. It ain't clear. You Lil, I got that from you. You ain't clear. Them people in Hollywood who say they saved in the music industry, it's like this. This is what it's like. Is that clear? Are they clear to you? You should show them. Your commitment and your life should be clearer than theirs. So it's one thing to say you are. You can be a secret agent Christian. But as a follower and a student, if what Jesus being your master is teaching is not influencing your lifestyle, something ain't right. Well, if he ain't, who is? What's his name? Okay. That's easy. That's an easy fix, ain't it? Yeah. Yeah. A disciple is first a believer who exercises faith, who has exercised his belief into faith. Jeremy said, I believe in Jesus Christ. He ain't got stuck there. I mean, Joe Nathan got stuck there. He was a closet Christian. He went no further in his faith. Stayed there for a year. Now he made a transition because Jalen's lifestyle convicted. And he went from faith in Christ to believing in Jesus to develop another kind of faith, which is going to lead him to more faith. That's how they go, saints. You don't stay with that same faith that you went to kindergarten with. Do we get that? No, it's time to move on. Listen, a disciple is first a believer. That's number one. You got to believe, right? All right. Who has exercised faith? This means they have experienced conversion. Who in here had an experience of conversion? Who in here had? All of us in here has experienced some type of conversion. Let me tell you what I've experienced at me before I got saved. I got worse and worse. I didn't stay just evil. I got evil up. I transitioned. And listen, it's possible for you to grow further than where you're at now. Don't think this is all God got for you and you can't go no further. That's not true. God wants you to grow up. He wants you to grow up. He's giving you everything. Add to your faith what? What do you add to as a student? You got to do what? You got an attitude. You got an attitude. I got the butter and eggs. What you going to do with that? Eat it? Butter and eggs will make a good meal because I eat eggs, scrambled, but guess what? You can do a lot with butter and egg, but you get some flour with it. You get some other stuff with it. You can hook up some stuff. But anyway, it says, and put Jesus at the center of their lives and participated in Christian imitation of Christ. You participate in imitating over there in the field. Be therefore imitators. Copy God. Copy God. Amen. As dearly beloved children. All right. Let's go to Acts, please. You got it. You reboot it. Is it back up? All right. Let's go to Acts 9, please. In 36. Let's check out this disciple. I'm surprised, you know. I'm surprised people hadn't mentioned this about. Can't no woman be no disciple. Can't no woman preach. Can't no woman do this. If a woman is a dentist, is a female pulling the teeth? Is her skill that God gave her that's doing the teeth, right? I guess some people going to remain chauvinistic. I had somebody come in here, they said, man, I enjoy your ministry. The daddy worked for the sheriff department, and his son, I didn't know who the man, but he said, you Daniel. I said, yeah. He said, my son enjoy coming to your service. I said, well, good. And really didn't know the young man. And one Sunday evening, he decided to come, and somebody was speaking, a woman from over there. He decided not to come back. He had a problem. He said, oh, well, women preach here? I ain't coming back. Fine with me. I had a guy come here and said, you don't preach out of the King James. I can't stay here. King James, the only true Bible. I said, bye. And he didn't understand what he would read. He thought he was intelligent, but he was just reading. He didn't know. He didn't know having it. Because to make that statement, I knew something was wrong with it. Here we go, y'all. Let's listen to this. Well, man, I'm in 836. Let me find. Here we go. Now, in Joppa, there was a certain disciple. Look at Luke. Pen this. Under the power of the Holy Spirit. Listen now. Listen to what he called this lady. This is a lady. Then all who lived, that's 35. Let me highlight this so I can, bear with me, please. Let me highlight these scriptures. I can pick them up then. Amen. Oh. All right, here we go. Then all, I'm still at 35. I'm going to read it since that's the second time. Then all who lived at Lydia at the plain of Sharon saw what had happened to him. And they turned to the Lord. That's the paralyzed man that Peter said, look on us, amen, gathered and found. All right, now, in Joppa, there was a disciple named Tabitha. There was a disciple named Tabitha. What is a disciple? A verbal, visible. She was visible. Everybody knew it. Everybody saw. Clearly, they saw her. Knowing that she was real. Wasn't nothing fake about it. She was real. She was real. She was a disciple. Because her works identified her as a disciple. And Luke, through the power of the Holy Spirit, wrote it. He penned it. Now in Joppa, there was a disciple. How do we know? The Bible said, do the Bible lie? No, it don't. Name Tabitha, which is translated into the Greek, mean Dorcas. She was rich in acts of kindness and charity, which she continually did. She was a visible, verbal disciple, not in name only. Do you get me? She was a widow herself. Guess what she did? She was a seamstress. Guess what else she did? She had a ministry helping the widows. Back in the day, nobody helped a widow. If you was a widow, you were poor, and you just had to fend for yourself because they didn't think much. God had a welfare system. He told the rich folk, don't glean the fields, leave the edges for the poor. Some of them were so hard-hearted, they would get all of it and wouldn't leave them nothing. God even told them at the year of Jubilee, all debts go back. All debts are canceled. And when we got close to year of Jubilee, one of their fellow Jews needed something, they wouldn't give it to them because they couldn't get their money back. So wait a minute, what money is it? Oh, man, in another month, year of Jubilee coming. And the debt going to get canceled. I ain't giving you that. But this disciple, not a man, but a woman, had what? Acts of kindness toward widows. And she continually, habitually did. She was visible, verbal, in her commitment as a disciple. That's what Dr. Luke penned. He saw it. Guess what he noticed about Dorcas, Tabitha? Number one, she didn't run to third base. She went to first base, which made her thinking about the widows. And she helped. And she continually gave of herself. And she made sure these widows had. That's what a disciple does. That's what a follower of Christ does. They see the need. And God allowed her to see the need, stirred her heart, and moved on her. And she did something about the need. This ain't no man. This is a woman. And some people read that, they argue that fact. I think that was a misprint. A woman can't be no disciple. Okay. But she was committed. Can we get that? She was committed. The Bible says she was a what? Can we get back to the definition again? A disciple is first a believer who has exercised faith. This means that they have experienced conversion and put Jesus at the center of their life and participated in Christian imitation of Christ. Now, she didn't see Christ, but when the church got converted and started in Acts, she was in the thick of things of that church. She was in the higher upper echelon in the church of that day. She was all involved, okay? Okay? A disciple is a follower. A true disciple is not just involved, but is committed to take up his or her own cross and follow Jesus to the very end. Now, this is what she was doing. This is how Luke, who had been with Jesus, identified her. He saw it. Can somebody say, you are a disciple? Can somebody say, you are a visible, verbal follower, or you are a closet? See, you can't be no closet disciple. See, baptism was all our coming out party. Hello? You confess Christ at Boy Scout camp. You confess Christ at the Girl Scout camp. You was in private in a closed setting. Now, baptism puts you out there. That's your coming out party. Now, everybody know you are identified with Christ. But now, is that true? Everybody get baptized. Is that true? We want it to be true. I want it to be true. But it's not. Okay, let's finish reading this. Oh, my time about up, and we right on time. Let's get this. Listen, during that time, it happened that she became sick. Look at all this committedness this woman was doing. Love God and was faithful to God, but she got sick. Anybody tell you that you must got sin in your life? That's why you got sick. That's a lie from hell. No. Good people, this is a fallen world, saints. It's sin down here. This body is subjected to viruses, diseases, and all kind of things. Tabitha was a good disciple, but she got sick and died. Did y'all hear me? They must not have been right. They picked up, they ate that poison. I heard somebody say this. Somebody poisoned this preacher. Oh, he must not have been right, because if he had been God, he wouldn't have died. First of all, he probably know the woman was going to poison him anyway. Now, that's a whole other different situation. We cannot say that. Things happen. People love God. I'm talking about love God, get cancer, and die. End up dying by natural causes or something, heart attack, stroke, and love God. So don't ever say this person ain't close to God. That's why they got this. Or that's why they got corona. That's a lie. I ain't finna say that. But I will say this. Let's read. I'm going to say what the words say. Listen. She became sick and died. When they had washed her body, they laid it in an upstairs chamber or room. Since Lydia was near Joppa, the disciples, hearing that Peter was there. Now, what just happened with Peter? A miracle happened then. All right, what just happened? Peter ministered. Now Peter was traveling throughout the land. He went down to visit the saints, God's people who lived at Lydia. They found a man named Aeneas who had been bedridden for 8 years and were paralyzed. Peter said to him, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Get up. Make up your bed. Make your bed. And immediately Aeneas got up. Now, they heard all that. Peter was right down the road. Whoa, what's going on here? Peter there sent two men to him, urging him. Hearing that Peter was there, sent two men to him, urging him, come unto us without delay. 39, Peter got up at once and went with them. When he arrived, they brought him into the upstairs room, and all widows stood beside him weeping. Why? Because she had been so good to those widows. She really had a ministry to help those women. No, nobody helped these folk. But her work, saints, she loved God. And they called for Peter to do something about this situation. Now, I want you to sow something. So what you do, God noticed. God noticed what this woman was doing for him. This disciple, okay, stood beside weeping and showing him all the tunics and robes that Dorcas used to make while she was with them. But Peter sent them all out of the room and knelt down and prayed. Turning to the body, he said, Tabitha, arise. And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. And he gave her his hand and helped her up. Then he called in the saints, God's people, and the widows, and he presented her to them alive. Now, let me show you what happened here. Because she was so committed to helping the needy. God first, others second. Third, look what happened. God decided her. He wasn't through with her good works. And he raised her from the dead through Peter so she could continue. See, when you got God in number one spot, and it ain't just in a life and death, it's any situation that you put God first and you put others second because you love God. That's discipleship. And third, you, look what happened. She got her life back. Look at Cornelius. We can go to the 10th chapter. He was a man, an Italian man. He was a soldier. Did much good toward God's people. But he didn't know Jesus. sent Peter. Prejudice Peter. Just God worked through to bring a woman back from the dead. God said, I got to get this prejudice out of him. And then preached to that man and got him saved because of his works. He was already doing identifying work as a believer, as a disciple, and wasn't saved. How do you handle a situation? You see people doing all these great deeds and they love God, but yet not have heard the gospel. Peter preached to him. All his house got saved. He would call his relative, come on over here. I got a preacher coming that's going to preach the word. And not only him, but he told them, come on, come on. He packed the house. Peter saved his whole house and relative. What is I'm saying? Tabitha was a disciple. She was visible. She was verbal in her following. Her works identified it, didn't it? Can you pull this up? Give me James 2:14. If I'm not, my other knee trying to go out. Wow, ain't that something? Yeah, 3:14. We're getting ready to close. Did that story help? I'm telling you, don't ever let nobody tell you, if you a God, you ain't gotta do this, and you don't supposed to get sick. A lie. All of us gonna leave here. And we're going to leave here. But let me tell you, when God ain't ready for you to go, you ain't going nowhere. If God ain't ready for you, you can ask God to take it. God controls that. You ain't finna go nowhere. Come on. Yeah. What does it profit, my brother, though a man say he has faith and have not worked? Did Dorcas have faith? Did Tabitha have works? To read 10th chapter of Acts. Cornelius had faith. He had works, didn't he? Yes. And you a believer and you got work. Think about the people that God put in your path daily. Stir your heart to move. That's why he stirred your heart to move in that situation. I'm glad when I'm somewhere and not even thinking about it, something happened in front of me. I got that. Oh, I was at the water company one day. And this guy didn't have enough for his water. And I'm sitting there, and he was like, oh, I ain't got it. I went in my pocket. I knew what I had. I said, oh, man. And I didn't even look at him if I had to take that. He just looked perplexed. Because, see, God was blessing me over here while what I was doing. And, see, when I heard it, I don't ear hustle like that. But God allowed me to hear that. I was not going to leave when this man needed some services and I could help. God ain't asking you to help everybody. He's not asking you to help the world. But whom he allowed to come in front of you and it stirs your heart to move, you setting yourself up for a reprisal to come. It might not be raising you from the dead, but it may be raising you from a dead situation. It may be healing you from this. It may be bringing you out of that. But God gonna remember your kind acts. He said, he that lendeth to the poor, lendeth to the Lord. God knows what he's doing now. Come on. So let your work speak for you. I'm a Christian. Let your work speak. Don't say nothing. Don't you say nothing. Are you a Christian? You see my works. Check them out. And have not worked? Can faith save him? Can faith save this brother right here? Nah. So it's more than just believe, ain't it? If we ain't got nothing else, we understand what believing is here, don't we? Don't we? We understand that everybody going to have to use the faith that God gave them. No, that faith ain't hitting on nothing. Come on, that's counterfeit money that you buy out of Walmart and play cash register with that big old fake cash register with that play money. If a brother or sister, this is how we know faith without works is dead. If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, come on, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled. Hallelujah! Glory to God in the highest. Yes, Lord. And you did all that and wouldn't feed them. See, that's supposed to say I was a Christian. But I mean, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. That's theatrics. That's play acting. and be ye warm and filled. Notwithstanding, you give them not those things which are needful to the body. What does it profit? It don't. Come on. Come on. Even so, faith has not works is dead being alone. You got faith and no work. Faith plus works equal disciple. True disciple. We saw Tabitha right there. If you read 10th chapter, you'll see Cornelius. That man was helping the Jews out. Man, this man was pouring it on. He was doing great deeds. And God said, I can't let this go unnoticed. I got to get the gospel to this man. Come on. Come on. Yeah, man may say, thou hast faith, and I have work. Show me thy faith without thy work. You can't. Can you show somebody your belief in fighting without you fighting? Man, I love to fight. You ain't nobody ever seen you fight. But this joker, he ain't never said he loved to fight. Every day he fighting, beating up somebody. What we gonna say? Man, you love to fight. But if your faith is there, then we'll know. Man may say, thou hast faith and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. You show your faith that you have faith by what you do. How far are you willing to go? Jesus said, if a man, a Roman soldier, would be going somewhere and see a Jew and he had his back set and he was approaching the hill, Jesus said, if you see somebody going up a hill and they ask you to go 1 mile, huh, take this and walk up here with me. He said, go two. Did I lose everybody? No, Jesus said, do too. Go extra. Because God is always giving you extra. He don't even act for it. Don't even recognize you're getting extra. Oh, Lord. I said, come on. Come on. Thou believest that there is one God. Thou dost well, don't we? The devil also believes there is one God. And he ain't just believing. He's trembling with his belief. Come on. But will thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Don't say you got faith and no nothing works to bag it up. Work out your own what? We got to become students, and how are we going to work if we ain't being taught? The Bible said the wise will hear and increase in learning and become skillful that you may be able to steer your own course. Come on. We got a few more to go in here and we close. Was Abraham our father justified? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered up Isaac, his son, upon the altar? Yeah. God said, now I know, didn't he? He said, now I know, Abraham, you won't withhold nothing from me. Abraham was rich. God didn't want money. Abraham would give. That wasn't the problem. God wanted that son. Can I go to a story? What was that woman named that the priest thought she was drunk? What was her name? Rebecca. What was her name? Hannah. Yeah, Hannah. She thought she was drunk. She didn't have no children. But she wanted a child. And she was going there praying. I mean, she was earnestly praying. He said, woman, put the wine away from you. You drunk. She said, no, my Lord, I'm not drunk. He said, well, whatever it is, may the Lord grant it to you. But she said in her heart, Lord, if you bless me with a son, I'll wean him and give him back. Let me say something. That was all God was after anyway. God needed a prophet. He needed a prophet. And he knew a woman that was earnestly a good woman and was barren, but he wanted a broken and crying and snotting. And she messed up and said, Lord, if you bless me with a man child, a son, I'll nurse him and wean him and give him to you. God said, I'm going to give you what you want and I'm going to get what I want. See, y'all ain't getting that. Did you get that? By her committing her son to the Lord, she had 5 more children that could be hers. She gave the first one and God gave her 5 more. Me, clear? Is this clear? No, but that's clear, ain't it? You get it first. Hannah gave that child, and God blessed her womb to have five or four more children. That was all God after, because he needed a prophet. He needed Samuel. And he told her what to name the child, didn't he? If God gets you, guess what else coming? Whoa, many gonna look at you and be just awestruck. This person is saved. You know how many people you can lead to Christ? You know how many people you have probably turned off from Christ? I'm asking, have you thought about that? I've thought about that. How many people have I made Jesus unattractive to and will never come back to him? But how many people, through your obedience, have made Jesus look so attractive that they want to be saved, and you have no idea that they want Jesus. They want the Jesus you've been presenting. Saints of God, Tabitha went right back to helping the widows. She didn't stop. Oh, well, I'm going to take my rest now, saying, God raised me from the dead. I'm going to live my life and do what I want to do. No, she went back doing the same thing. Amen. Did that help anybody? Visible, verbal, follower, student, not a secret agent. Not a secret agent. Amen. Did that help anybody? So you being a disciple or a student, you got to become visible and verbal. Amen. Listen, if the master, Lord, teachings are not influencing your thinking and altering your life and changing as you go, he's not your Lord yet. You can be a secret agent Christian, but to be a disciple, you got to be visible, verbal, follower. Just can't do it privately. This is our word for today. I hope somebody was blessed today.